pleasant. Good morning, folks. On behalf of the management and staff of K. Allen and Sons Funeral Directors Limited, and on my own behalf, personally, please accept our sincere condolences at this time. If you'd be kind enough to bow your hearts with me for a moment, let's pray, and then we'll make room for the eulogy. Father in heaven, this morning we come before you in humility. We acknowledge that you kept us safe during another night, and you allowed us to be awake this morning and to be about our business. Your word declares that your mercies are new every morning, and for this we are thankful. We acknowledge your goodness towards us, even in the midst of heartache and trials, even in the midst of challenges and opposition. We can trace your hand, and we are thankful that you care for us so much. And Father, even when we don't care about you, you still show us care. This morning, as we've come into this place together, we've come with broken hearts. And God, you are the God who mends broken hearts. And so we look to you today, asking you to mend every broken heart. Those in the chapel, those via the live stream. Father, we ask you to address every heart's cry today and to meet each person at the point of their need. There's nothing hid from you. You're aware of all that confronts us and all that we're struggling with. And we ask you to help us not only in relation to Jean's passing, but in relation to all of the other issues at the same time that we're confronted with. So we wait on you today, and we ask you to speak into our lives and to minister to us right where we need you to. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen and amen. We want to make way for the eulogy at this time.
Morning, everyone. Morning. Today we are gathered to honor the life and memory of our beloved Jean Marjorie Arrindell, also known as Mums or Mumsy. Her strength, wisdom, and generosity touched each one of us in a unique way, and her presence continued to be felt even now that she is gone. My grandmother was a woman who believed in what she said, a headstrong, determined, and God-fearing individual. She was always willing to share knowledge when it comes to the Bible, and she would always teach others how to take care of themselves with herbal remedies. You cannot go up her stairs and leave empty-handed. She was a very generous person, always willing to give. Moms will offer you anything from herbs, plants, clothes, food, cash, and even a slight criticism of your looks. I could always remember the days when I stayed with her and I was not feeling well. Mom ensured that she made a herbal solution to make me feel better. Her favorite furniture was the rocking chair. When she sat on that rocking chair, she would be sipping on a hot cup of tea. She loved her hot cup of ginger or peppermint tea to soothe her stomach. Mom's loved her flower plants and vegetable garden. As I can remember long ago, the front of her house was filled with many plants. One thing, if you wanted to remain on her good side, do not mess with Mirbel Jean plants. Only hear what I'm telling you all. You couldn't mess with that woman plant and not expect to get a serious bruising. If you make her get angry, she would give you a good piece of her mind. Today and tomorrow, you and her would be best of friends. She is not a person to hold anyone in mind. And that is why I love my grandmother. Moms left and lived a very fulfilling life, leaving behind an incredible legacy of more than 30 grandchildren, 56 great-grandchildren, contrary to what the program now said, 56 and more great-grandchildren, and 11 great-great-grandchildren and counting, who will continue to carry on her values and cherish the memories for generations to come. She always rejoiced and said, "I was blessed because of my age." Even when she was at her last, as she would say, "Many might not live to see my age the way this world is going." Even in her latter years, Mons was still passionate about living life to its fullest. She would dress herself and go out. As she would say, "I'm going to knock about." Although she is no longer with us, in this moment, our hearts are filled with appreciation for all those moments we shared with her. We can take comfort in knowing that she has gone peacefully to her final resting place, where she will be forever looked after by the Lord Almighty. Moms, you will be missed by us all, and may your soul rest in peace, in eternal grace and light.
Thank you. His eyes on the sparrow. We have somebody coming to help us. Yes, please.
Pleasant good morning, everyone. Condolences to all the relatives. I'd like to sing a song here to give you a little word of encouragement. You know, God is in charge of everything in this time of grief. Why should the shadows come? Why should my heart feel lonely and long for heaven and home? When Jesus is my portion, my constant friend is He. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know He watches me. I sing because I'm happy. I sing because I am free. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know He watches me. Let not your heart be troubled. His tender words I hear, and resting on His goodness, I lose my doubts and fear. Though through by the past He leadeth, but one step I may see. His eye is on the sparrow,
and I know He watches me. It's on the sparrow, and I know He watches me. He watches me. Whenever I am tempted, whenever clouds will arise, when songs give place to sighing, when hope within me dies, I draw too close to Him. From care He sets me free. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know He watches me. His eye is on the sparrow, He watches me. Keep courage, family. Hallelujah. The sparrow, and I know He watches me.
She take my program too. Thank you, but I know she didn't mean to steal it, so we good. Amen. Isaiah chapter 66, verses 13 and 14 says, "As one whom his mother comforts, so will I comfort you, and you shall be comforted. And when you see this, your heart shall rejoice, and your bones shall flourish like an herb, and the hand of the Lord shall be known toward his servants." As one whom his mother comforts, so will I comfort you, and you shall be comforted. And when you see this, your heart shall rejoice, and your bones shall flourish like an herb, and the hand of the Lord shall be known toward his servants. The song that just went, his eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me. I have one problem. I've only recently developed one problem with that song. Because the chorus says, "I sing because I'm happy, and I sing because I'm free." And that's reasonable. That's usually the time when we sing. But when you listen to the verses of the song, the verses paint a picture of things not being so bright. So then the chorus kind of really doesn't kind of go with it. And I think the chorus should be, "I sing even when I'm not happy. And I sing even though I'm sad." Why? Because his eye is not just simply on the sparrow, but because I know his eye is on the sparrow, I know he's watching me. You see, Jesus spoke this talking to his disciples, and he was talking to them about the anxieties that we have with life, trying to figure out everything, to make ends meet, how we will get this, how we'll get that, what we will eat, what we will put on, what we will drink, where we will live, how we will survive. And he's trying to direct their hearts to learn to trust in the God who made them to begin with. And he says, listen, he says, consider the sparrows, consider the birds of the air. He said, they don't work, yet not one of them falls to the ground without our Heavenly Father knowing. He says, are you not worth much more than them? He said, consider the lilies of the field. Solomon in all his glory wasn't arrayed
like one of them. And none of them, he says, they don't toil, they don't spin. Father, make sure they grow up, they blossom. They give out a wonderful fragrance. And they don't actually do anything to make that happen. Father is who makes them grow. He says, you are worth much more than all the lilies in the field. So if he takes care of the birds and he takes care of the lilies in the field, will he not much more rather take care of you? Ever so often throughout the Bible, God makes these interjections where he reminds his people, and by extension, he reminds us of his care for us, of his love for us, of his concern for us. And I know sometimes we question that because things are so crazy sometimes. We wonder if he really does care and if he really does love us. And I think that is only reasonable for us to have that little bit of confusion sometimes, because sometimes things get really so mad. You wonder how could God be looking and not doing something about this? Yet, I hear the psalmist often basically putting forth the same question. And sometimes not even in a question form, but literally telling God to his face, you're responsible for this. You have abandoned me, and look at the condition you have me in. I can't eat, I can't drink, me. I'm getting skinny because, I mean, everybody wants to kill me. The people who are supposed to be my friends ganging up against me. And it seems as though you and all they even pay no attention to me, because you just have me like a pelican in the wilderness, like a sparrow on the house, like an owl in the desert. You ain't really studying me at all. But what fascinates me is that in the same breath that the psalmist is expressing this concern and asking these questions and literally challenging God, in the very same breath, he says, but God, you are the lift up of my head. You are my hope. You are my refuge. You are my peace. You are my strength. You are my strength. You are my fortress. You are my deliverer. In you I will trust. I have nowhere else to turn. I can get angry at you because you haven't done what I think you should do. But then where am I going to go after I get angry with you? Who am I going to turn to comfort me? Who am I going to turn to give me? Who am I going to turn to mend my broken heart when I get vexed with you because you didn't do things the way I thought you should do it? And here in this passage, he says, as a mother comforts her child. And I find, like, even God does be a little bit biased sometimes. People that hardly talk about men, fathers comforting their children, always mothers comforting children. Like if fathers can't do nothing. We know how to comfort too. We know how to love our children too. We know how to rock our children to sleep and make tea for them and give them the tea and make sure it's not too hot and it's just right. We know how to change their diapers and powder them. And we know how to do that too. But nobody talks about fathers doing those things. And the minute I get started, my wife does say I have a beef with how fathers have been treated. Mother's Day is a big, big thing, and Father's Day is a small thing, so and whatnot. So let me not get carried away. But God says, as a mother comforts her child or her children, so will I comfort you. And forgive me, I'm not here today just in reference to Jean's passing, but there are so many other issues that all of us are dealing with and confronted with every day. There's so many things rocking our brains and stressing us out. And sometimes we, and very often, we are looking for some kind of rest, some kind of peace. Shadow sang many, many years ago. We're looking for some kind of way to ease the tension. We're looking for some kind of way to just kind of find a little bit of tranquility, a little bit of quietness. And we try running away from here and running away from there and running to this place or to that place. Or we try this situation or that one. And none of it works, because after we come back out from wherever that is, everything is still there. And God says, I will comfort you, and you shall indeed be comforted. The Bible refers to God in the book of Corinthians as the Father of mercies and the God of all comfort, who comforts us in all our troubles. My point is, we are faced with stuff that disturbs us. And every single one of us want peace and quietness. And I'm saying to us, that peace and that quietness that we're looking for is found in the Lord Jesus Christ. And God says, he says, just as a mother comforts a child, I will comfort you. And when you see this, your heart shall rejoice and your bones will flourish. The Bible says brokenness is like rottenness in the bones. A broken heart paralyzes you. A broken heart paralyzes your ability to live. It will even lead to sickness and disease in your body. The Bible says, but when hope flourishes, it's like a tree of life. You spring back to life, and your heart is made glad once again. And I'm saying to us, we try to fulfill that in all different kind of ways. And I'm saying to us today, please leave here understanding that the peace that you've been looking for all your life, all the different things you've tried to find, and everything has failed, and the thing that you're trying right now ain't working out either, is because peace is never found in things. Comfort is never found in things. Comfort is found in the same place that peace is found. It's found in a person. And that person is the Lord Jesus Christ. No other human being could give you peace. Somebody will come and hug you today, and you'll feel comforted for a while. But eventually they have to leave you and go their way. And then you're still left all alone. Where you're going, how you're going to be comforted then? When everybody is wherever they are, and you're alone to deal with your memories, and your worries, and your frustrations, and your problems. And nobody's answering the phone when you call. And the text message seems to just be lingering there. None of the blue ticks come up for you to see that the person has seen the message. And you're wondering and you're still waiting. How long are you going to just wait for somebody to step in to give you that comfort? And all while you're waiting, your heart is literally pining away. And Jesus would say in Matthew 28 and verse 11, or chapter 11, verse 28, come unto me, all you that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. God says, as one whom his mother comforts, so I will comfort you. Whether it be because your heart is broken today because Jean is no longer here, or because of one of those other issues in life, God says, I will comfort you. One of the things I've found with him is that he stands by his word. He is true. If he said he will comfort you, believe you me, he will. Just allow him to. Allow him to walk with you through the issues of your life. He is faithful and he is committed to see you through all the way to the end. I think we're going to sing the goodness of God. I done preach and they didn't clap for me, but it's okay. No, it's not a problem.
I love you, for your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. And all my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. I love your voice. You have held me through the fire and darkest night. You are close like no other. I've known you as a father. I've known you as a friend. Oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. And all my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down, I surrender now. I give you everything. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down, I surrender now. I give you everything. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. And all my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness. All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. Oh, I will sing of the goodness of God.
Amen. Can I ask you to stand with me for a moment? We're going to pray, and then our friend is going to come back to do our last song, during which time we'd open the coffin, give you a few moments to view Jean, say your farewells. If you haven't yet signed the condolence book, it's all the way across to my left. Before we leave, please sign it, and then we'll be on to interment at the Dabadi Public Cemetery. But let's pray. If you're comfortable enough doing this, could you hold the hand of the person next to you? Or somebody tell me we're still in COVID times and things, so don't do that too much. But so I usually ask if you're comfortable doing it. Amen. Father, we stand here today, hand in hand, shoulder to shoulder. We stand here today as family members, relatives, friends, I would expect neighbors also. We stand here today as a people in need of your grace. Your grace, which is more than sufficient for any and all of our needs. We stand here today, Father, people that are in need of your peace that passes all understanding.
to keep our hearts and our minds through your Son, Jesus Christ. We stand here today, Father, people that are in need of our broken hearts being mended. Let the pieces be pulled together again, Lord God. We stand here today as a people that are in need of the ability to rejoice again, because there are so many things that have been bombarding so many of us, Lord, that laughter has become a strange thing. A genuine smile has become a difficult thing to express because there's just been so much heartache. But Father, we know that to everything there is a season and a time to every purpose under the heaven. So we pray that the changing of this season would come where joy and gladness would replace mourning and weeping and grieving. We ask that you would walk with this family through this crisis, through this time of brokenness, Lord. You would sustain them and you would keep them and you would hold them. Fathers, they would leave here momentarily to make their way to the place of interment. We ask, God, that you would go before this company of people. As we will commit Jean Marjorie Arrindell's body to the earth from which it came, we thank you today for the moments that you gave her with her loved ones. We thank you for today, Father, for every day that you gave her life. We thank you for her the ability you gave her to invest her life into others. And we want to say thank you, Father God, for the fact that she was here and their lives have been impacted by her life. We therefore release her body from us today as we commit her loved ones into your hands. Keep them. Look after them. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And amen.
Hey, I'll make you sing about habit now. I'll Fly Away, our last song, while we view her body.
This world is not my home.
Sorry. That's okay. Some glad morning when this life is over, I'll fly away a home on God's celestial shore. I'll fly away. I'll fly away, oh glory. I'll fly away. When I die, hallelujah, by and by, I'll fly away. When the shadows of this life have gone, I'll fly away. Like a bird from prison bars have flown, I'll fly away. I'll fly away, oh glory, I'll fly away. When I die, hallelujah, by and by, I'll fly away. Just a few more weary days and then I'll fly away to a land where joy shall never end. I'll fly away. I'll
fly away. When I die, hallelujah, by and by, I'll fly away.
When I was learning to drive, there was a driving school. I think it was Dennis and Leela's, and their slogan was, "You learn fast. You will learn well fast, this clapping thing." Amen. Please take the next few moments. You want to come forward to view her body, say your farewells. Don't forget to sign the condolence book also, please. And it's raining outside, not very, very, very nice. So we'd want to try to maximize the weather whenever it eases up. All right. We will need the assistance of some men when we're ready to take her out to the hearse, so from by the door when we're ready. So for the meanwhile, please feel free if you want to come forward. And don't forget to sign the condolence book. May the Lord bless and keep each and every one of you.
This world is not my home, I'm just a passing through. My treasures are laid up somewhere beyond the blue. The angels beckon me from heaven's open door, and I can't feel at home in this world anymore. Oh Lord, you know I have no friend like you. If heaven's not my home, then Lord, what will I do? The angels beckon me from heaven's open door, and I can't feel at home in this world anymore. I have a loving mother just over in glory land, and I don't expect to stop until I shake her hand. She's waiting now for me in heaven's open door, and I can't feel at home in this world anymore. Oh Lord, you know I have no friend like you. If heaven's not my home, then Lord, what will I do? The angels beckon me from heaven's open door, and I can't feel at home in this world anymore. Just over in glory land we'll live eternally. The saints on every hand are shouting victory. Their songs of sweetest praise drip back from heaven's shore, and I can't feel at home in this world anymore. Oh Lord, you know I have no friend like you. If heaven's not my home, then Lord, what will I do? The angels beckon me from heaven's open door, and I can't feel at home in this world anymore.